change. All right, welcome back, everyone, to this semester seminar series, Barshop Seminar Series. Today's speaker to start off the semester is Zachary Pincus. Zachary went to both his to get his bachelor's and his PhD at Stanford University in California. Then he did his postdoc with Dr. Frank Slack at Yale University. During his postdoc, he received a K99 and is now in his R00 phase. And since 2013, he has been an assistant professor at Washington University in St. Louis. So I've met Zach a few times at various age meetings and C. elegans meetings. So it's great to have him and hear the latest on his really neat system and study of worm aging. And since he's started his new lab, he's had a few, started to get the publications going. There's some senior author papers in Cell Systems and in Nature Communications. So I think he's gonna be doing great, like he did in his postdoc. So Zach, and it's the title, I can't read it from here.
That's all right, I'll
It's really long. It's Long Life in the Worms.
Yes, I'm going to see. Oh, that's on. There we go. All right, that should be working. Let me turn on my microphone. Everyone hear me okay? How about you out there in TV land? Can you, hello. I'm going to unmute you guys so you can holler questions if you have any questions. But if you start talking amongst yourselves, I'm gonna mute you back there. And that goes for you as well. I can't mute you, but please do holler out questions throughout. It's more fun when it's interactive. Okay, so this is the entire life of one individual C. elegans. So on each day of the animal's life, I'm showing superimposed the position of the animal from a few seconds apart, so you can get a sense of the relative amount of movement. And then the color is according to the average level of intestinal autofluorescence. It's a material that builds up over time and can't be hydrolyzed. It's sort of the worm equivalent of liver spots. And so I think in this short life of a humble nematode, we can nevertheless see a microcosm of our own lives. Juvenile growth followed by a all too short period of young adult vigor, and then the slow, inevitable decline into senescence, loss of metabolic homeostasis, and ultimately death. These animals, of course, are famously Nobel Prize winningly invariant in their early development. But what's amazing to me is that each individual within a population meets its demise at very different times and in very different ways. And I hasten to add, this is a genetically identical population. Each individual is not too many generations removed from a single self-fertilizing, completely inbred hermaphrodite great-great-grandparent. So you don't get more genetically identical than these animals. And we're rearing them in extraordinarily homogeneous conditions. Yet nevertheless, there's this huge range in lifespan. So the fundamental question I really want to address in my lab is how are long-lived individuals different from their short-lived but otherwise identical siblings? Is it just random damage accumulation over time? The slings and arrows, or maybe better, the high-energy photons and reactive oxygens of stochastic fortune? Or are there biological states that are defined early in life, perhaps even during development, that underlie an animal is going to age gracefully or less gracefully? So that's the basic question I want to address. And in this lecture and in my lab, we try to factor this out into a few different sub-questions. First, when in life are differences between long and short-lived individuals established? Is this something that happens early or happens late? Second, what are the genetic drivers of these differences? Again, these are genetically identical animals, but is there a gene expression basis for long versus short life? And if so, when does that emerge? And then finally, how does the rubber meet the road? What is the physiology of C. successful aging versus unsuccessful aging. Do long-lived animals age in a healthier way or not? And so I'm going to try to address those questions today. Now, for those of you who are not nematode aficionados, let me give you a quick tour of the nematode. So they're about a millimeter long, 100 microns in diameter, mostly given over to intestine and gonad, metabolism and reproduction, two chief determinants of aging. They've got some neurons thrown in there. They're about a third neurons like we are, held together with some skin and muscle. And in about 3 days, they can go from an egg to a reproductively mature adult. And then the lifespan is on average 14, you know, a couple weeks after that. So it of course is no surprise that in this simple, fast-living animal, we can do rapid longevity experiments. And of course, probably the most famous figure in the aging field was generated in worms. This is Cynthia Kinnion's identification of a mutant that lives longer than wild type. And so this really set the template for the whole field. People do something to worms or to any critter and look for a change in the mean lifespan. Look for a change to extend the mean or median or maximal lifespan. What can you do to extend lifespan? It's really been the dominant paradigm. But I think by focusing on this sort of mean so much, that the field has let really a key lifespan determining process hide in plain sight for over a quarter century since this work was published. And that is, what about the variance around the mean, right? What does it make this individual different from that one? And I think that understanding this variance is really important for two reasons. The first is that almost no lifespan extending interventions reduce the variance. And here you can see that the variance has actually increased as the mean has increased. And what that tells me is that whatever is controlling the variability around the mean is different biologically than what's controlling the mean. And so maybe we could control them both. Maybe we could extend the mean lifespan, and if we understood the variance determination well enough, we could also arrange it so that every individual gets the maximal benefit from that intervention. And the second reason is that in humans, even outbred humans, genetic variability really determines or really explains only a small fraction of the total variability in lifespan. So that is to say, in this room, we are all mostly wild type with respect to lifespan determination. And so really the question isn't about, you know, these insulin mutant animals. It's, am I going to be this fellow or that fellow? I would really like to know that. And you can also imagine that there's sort of clear, clinically actionable things you can do with that knowledge. So I think it's very natural to not just talk about the mean, but also ask questions about the variance. So why haven't people been asking these questions? And in part, you know, it's partially because it is a little bit of a blind spot in the field, but I think, moreover, it's just really hard to do right, because to understand why some individuals live longer, you can't just count dead worms at the end of the assay. We need to follow each individual throughout its life. You have to do a longitudinal assay to understand variability within the population. So this is difficult, even in worms, even in simple model organisms. Longitudinal studies are a pain. But we came up with some technology to address that so that we can actually do these kind of assays. So this is the standard culture conditions for C. elegans. It's many individuals crawling around on an agar plate, eating a lot of food bacteria. And, you know, they're tiny and they look the same. You can't put ear tags in them. You just don't know who's who in this kind of scenario. So what we did was basically we tried to miniaturize this into a single animal culture condition. And this is work that was done by Will Pittman, a bioengineering graduate student in the lab. So I'm just going to walk you through the sort of the protocol so that you get a sense of what our culture system is. So we start with an aluminum frame on a glass slide, making a little reservoir. And we fill that with PEG monomers, polyethylene glycol monomers, that cross-link into place. So it's sort of like a polyacrylamide gel, except it uses non-toxic monomers, which is nice. So this gives us a really uniform, very flat hydrogel surface. And onto the gel, we deposit tiny pads of the bacterial food source, and then painstakingly transfer individual C. elegans eggs onto each pad. But the really fun bit is next we cover the whole thing in PDMS silicone. So this is the stuff people use to make microfluidic devices out of. It goes on as a liquid, and then overnight it polymerizes into a tough, yet gas-permeable and optically transparent membrane that separates the worms and the whole device from the rest of the world. But what I'm especially proud of is we arranged the chemistry such that not only is this PDMS cross-linking with itself, but it's also cross-linking with the hydrogel underneath, everywhere those two materials are in contact, which is to say everywhere except where the food pads are. So each individual animal is sealed into its little envelope by strong covalent bonds in every direction. And so each animal is basically constrained onto this very uniform environment throughout its entire life. And so that was a cartoon. Here's sort of more of a schematic of what the device looks like. And we've recently published this. There's a detailed protocol available for anyone who's interested. But what this enables us to do, then, is to follow individual animals throughout their entire lives. Here's an eggshell. Here's an animal that has just hatched out of its egg. And then we can get really incredible resolution on these animals. These clearings that you see, these sort of semicircular clearings, those are the nuclei of a cell, of the intestinal cell. So we're seeing subcellular resolution on a live, freely moving, unanesthetized animal, and we can do that 3 times a day, 10 times a day throughout the animal's entire life. The worm aficionados will be able to pull out some developmental markers. And of course, we can watch the individuals until the very moment of death. And we can see the biology of senescence unfold before our eyes. And the system is also great for fluorescence imaging. So again, we're getting great resolution from totally unperturbed animals. Carl?
Is that your worms?
Good question. Yeah, they're self-fertile hermaphrodites. This would be a problem if they're just filling their little pen with offspring. So what we've been doing, we use a temperature-sensitive sterile background. I'll show some videos in a second. You'll see them laying little black blobs, and those are unfertilized oocytes. So their entire reproductive system is working right, which is important for aging, of course. But it's the sperm and the egg can't bind because of a defective integrin. So it's actually a super nice allele that seems to have no effects on any other aspects of physiology. That's a good question. Okay. So again, this is sort of one animal over its life, but the promise of the system is that we can look at many, many individuals. So here are animals imaged every 15 minutes throughout their larval development, which we're clocking by these sort of first through fourth larval stage thermometers. And you can see they're getting bigger, they're crawling around, they're molting, they're doing all the things that worms do, and then they become reproductively mature, but they're laying these unfertilized oocytes. So this is development. This is 3 days of development at 15-minute intervals. And then, of course, there's aging. They have a sort of brief period of reproductive maturity, and then they become post-reproductive adults. And then, again, we can watch as senescence and mortality unfolds, again, at very different times in these really genetically identical and environmentally uniform individuals. So, and I should mention, developmental timing and lifespan are not at all affected by these culture conditions. And so we can start to ask a question. Now, we've seen many individuals with different lifespans throughout their entire lives. So we can rewind the tape and early in life try to ask, who is going to live longer and why? So let's play a game. Here's the first, 6 days. For 6 days. For two different individual animals, who do you think is going to live longer, the top one or the bottom one? Everyone, who's with the top one? Okay, how about the bottom? Okay, so there's some question about whether the large, vigorous animal is going to live longer or the shrunken, pathetic animal. So it turns out that the shrunken, pathetic animal dies right away. Yeah, the worms do not play against stereotype. But you can, sort of qualitatively, we can see that there are these massive differences between the individuals. And so what we want to do now is make this a little more quantitative to try to understand the physiology leading up to extended versus premature mortality. So to do that, the first problem we have to solve is, okay, where is the worm in the image? And that seems easy because we're really good at doing image analysis with our eyes. We have, you know, millions of years of evolutionary history of not getting eaten by tigers in the jungle. Our computers don't have that evolutionary lineage, but we got them to find worms and find the worm food pads. And then once you can find the worm, you can start making quantitative measurements. So, for example, I'm going to plot two scores, the total movement and the number of eggs laid for each animal that you're seeing here, and the animal highlighted in green is the one that we're going to follow. So, you know, again, we can sort of follow them throughout their entire lives. We can make quantitative measurements of aging-relevant physiology and ask how these measurements and how the trajectories of these measurements relate to an individual's eventual lifespan. That's a great question. So for the non-worm people in the audience, the state-of-the-art method of determination of worm live or deadness is basically what five-year-old boys do the world over. You poke it with a stick and see if it moves. But we can't poke these with a stick. Fortunately, they are... There's a really well-stereotyped escape response to blue light. These are sort of soil dwellers. They want to get out of the sun. And so we give them a stimulus of blue light and see if they try to move. And so it's pretty clear where they're dead. But yeah, it is fundamentally movement-based. And you can get into some really interesting philosophical discussion about what does it actually mean for a worm to be dead, and we can talk about that maybe later. But we operationalize it with failure to respond to a noxious stimulus. Okay. All right, so given that we found the position of the worm in all the images, we can make a variety of quantitative measurements. We can measure its morphology. We can measure how big the thing is. We can look at its tissue integrity. And we actually have quantitative computer vision methods to do this. And I can talk about that in more detail for those who are interested. But basically, we can... looking at the texture, say, is this animal look young and vigorous, or does it look like its insides are starting to get scrambled? Does it look like things are falling apart? So we have a score of bright field tissue integrity. We can also measure fluorescence, this intestinal autofluorescence or fluorescent transgenes. We can measure movement rates pre and post stimulus, and also the production rate of these unfertilized oocytes. A student in my lab, Nicolette, in computational biology, is actively working on expanding the repertoire of physiology that we can measure optically and non-invasively in these animals. Okay, so how do we relate these measurements to lifespan? So let me go through sort of a proof of concept example to show you the kind of analysis that we do and how we think about it. So what I've plotted here is for 460-odd animals, the length of the animal, sort of a good measure of its body size, as a function of time, as a function of age for each individual. And I'm coloring the plots from cool colors to warm colors according to the lifespan of the individual. All right, and so what is this? This is a mess. But that's okay. My whole point in life is to study variability, so I'm glad that there's a lot of variability here to study. Nevertheless, for visualization purposes, what I'm going to do throughout the rest of the talk is to present means for cohorts of different lifespans. So the warm color is the longest lived cohort of individuals, and this is the average length over time for long-lived individuals versus short-lived individuals. So we can see, the lines separate. Short-lived individuals become distinct from long-lived individuals in terms of their body size relatively early in life. Most of the die-off in the population starts around day 7, day 8, and we're already seeing differences in the length. So this is sort of a qualitative picture of what's going on. To be more quantitative, what I'm going to say is, okay, we're going to look at body length in an early adulthood window, from between the onset of reproductive maturity to a point when about 98% of the animals are still alive.
Why do worms decline in size?
Yeah, good question. I don't know. So part of it is reproductive activity. They're filled with eggs and oocytes. Part of it seems to be tissue maintenance. As animals age, they lose cells, they lose some fluid homeostasis, they become a little more flaccid, and so you see this sort of thinning out of the animal and a bit of shrinkage as well.
Is it a real decline in mouth to tail length, or is it that they're becoming curled up?
No. So these are all mouth to tail length measurements.
They also have decreasing
fluid. Right. They're eating less, and there's clearly things going on with the body wall, collagens and cuticle that may sort of be causing them to shrink and be less mechanically resilient. But you know, people shrink too, right? It's got to be the same. And so in human terms, this sort of span is you know, from age sort of 15 to 35 or so. You know, so relatively young adult window. And we're going to take, within this window, we're going to ask, well, what's the mean size of the animal and what's the slope? Is it still growing or is it shrinking? And correlate those with lifespan. So these are what the scatter plots look like if we look at the average length or the shrinkage rate versus lifespan. So here we're plotting the slope in length or the mean length in this early adulthood window versus the individual's future total lifespan. And you can see that there's a relationship there. And the figure of merit we're going to use for the relationship is the R squared. That's what fraction of the total variability in lifespan is explained by variability in length, slope, or mean. Or, you know, we can put them together and do a multivariate regression. And if we do that, what this is saying is about a third of all variability in future lifespan can be explained early in life by how long the animal is and how quickly it's shrinking, which to my mind is pretty crazy, right? You know, early in life you can get a pretty good guess as to who's going to live long based on if they're hunched over or not, would be the human equivalent. So I should stand up straight. And so that's for you know, two measurements for a relatively simple parameter. If we put together all of the physiological parameters that we measure, the length, the autofluorescence, the sort of textural measure of tissue homeostasis, movement rates, into a multivariate regression, we get an R-squared of about 0.62. So almost two-thirds of all the variability in total lifespan can be explained by these sort of phenomenological, physiological measurements made well before most of the animals even start to consider dying. And so again, to my mind, that's like totally incredible that this process seems to be started so early. So I think that gives us sort of an answer to the first question that really early in adulthood, we really can see differences between animals that'll go on to live for a long time and a short time, at least physiological differences. But then the next question is, okay, so what are the genetic drivers? Is there a gene expression basis? Does genotype precede phenotype? Does gene expression precede changes in physiology? You would certainly hope so. And so what candidate gene, if you had to choose one gene that you thought might be, one pathway that you thought might be involved in lifespan determination, does anyone want to say it with me? Should we look at insulin signaling? Of course. But let me just remind you of the main players in insulin signaling, what they're called in worms. So the insulin receptor is DAF2. It goes to the standard PI3 kinase signal transduction cascade. AGE1 is one of the components of the PI3 kinase. And then it converges on this FOXO transcription factor that in worms is called DAF16. And when when there's no insulin signaling, that goes to the nucleus and upregulates stress responses that have the effect of increasing lifespan. There's your two-second tour of insulin signaling. And we've actually found in my lab as a postdoc that there's a microRNA that seems to negatively regulate several different steps in this signaling pathway. And they show that if you knock it out, the animal lives less long. If you overexpress it, so you get, you know, less insulin activity, the animal lives longer. And so this seemed like, okay, maybe is this a knob that within wild-type individuals fluctuates? Are there fluctuating levels of miR-71 in wild-type animals that could account for fluctuating levels of insulin responsivity that might determine the sort of wild type variability in lifespan. So that's the question. So how are we going to do this? Well, let's measure this. And of course, we can't do total RNA extraction on worms and still hope to see how long they're going to live after we've ground them up. That won't work. But we can get GFP reporters for this microRNA. So the question we're going to ask is, does a reporter from year 71 correlate with future lifespan? Everyone think that's a reasonable question to ask? Any questions? Okay. As we say, yes. I wouldn't have brought it up if it didn't work, right? But so here is the level of near 71 GFP, again, in these short-lived to long-lived cohorts. So we see long-lived animals both have a higher level of expression of this gene early in adulthood and hold on to their young adult high level of expression for longer. So it's interesting, right? These are gene expression differences that are really persistent over days, many days. So the animals seem to be in a sort of, you know, spectrum from high miR-71 expression to low miR-71 expression in a way that is well correlated with their future lifespan. And if you look at this, yeah. It appears to be the case, yeah.
And what about the decline in hue? Are those rates also similar?
They're pretty similar.
Okay. So the question is, when did they stop making more?
Yeah, when do they switch from feeling young to feeling old, I guess.
Right. Okay, and then is this one, when they stop reproduction, it's also around?
Same data set.
Kind of
this is around the end of the reproductive period, so to day five, day six, and then day seven. And then so this GFP alone, if you look at sort of the spatial trends in its expression as a function of time, we can predict about half of all the variability in lifespan within this population just based on the level of miR-71 GFP, again, early in life, before anyone started to die. So again, to me, that's crazy. One gene that's driving all of this, or seems to be driving all of this, and we'll get back to that question. What's the causal relationship here? And so this is work that I've done in my postdoc. I just sort of went through it arduously to give you guys a sense of the analysis that we do. And in my lab, Holly, one of my students, also a bioengineering student, has been systematically screening through lots of different microRNAs, looking for those that correlate with future lifespan. And now, why microRNAs? First off, you know, they're regulators of things. They're sort of professional gene regulators. So we're interested in the regulatory circuits that drive lifespan. And secondly, GFP reporters are great for microRNAs because basically transcription is pretty much the story for how active a microRNA is, unlike transcription factors where you need to worry about their subcellular localization. So this is sort of the simple assays to do. So that's why we're starting with microRNAs. And what I'm plotting here is the R-squared for future lifespan for a variety of microRNAs is a function of the time window that we're looking at. So 0 to 2 days post-hatch, we look at the average level of the microRNA, we look at its slope. Days 1 through 3, we look at the average level in that window and sort of the rate of change. And so you can see, so here's miR-71. It's still the reigning champion in terms of being able to predict lifespan. But we're finding a variety of different gene regulators that all seem to be telling us something about an animal's future fate. And some of which seem to be telling us a story really early in life, even potentially before adulthood. And so here I'm showing a couple plots of this day 1 through 3. So day 3 is sort of they're all reproductively mature at day 3. At day 1, they're, you know, second larval stage animals. And so these are the correlations between our ability to predict future lifespan and what their actual lifespan is. So we're getting, you know, R-squareds of 20 to 25% really early in life. So again, these seem to be gene expression patterns that are being driven very early that are having really profound effects on the animal's future life. So now obviously the question is, well, how do these biomarkers relate to one another? I mean, you don't have to do a lot of math to realize that, that these all add up to more than 100%. We can't explain more than 100% of the variability in lifespan. So, so clearly there's some redundancy in these markers. So we'd like to understand, you know, what is the structure of control of lifespan? What does the network structure look like, whereby gene regulators regulate something that, that in turn determines lifespan? And so broadly, these questions are, okay, how do we infer causation from correlative observations? What we've observed is that, that near 71 fluctuations correlate with fluctuations in lifespan. Right, that's just a correlation. And of course, all of genetics is about how do you infer causation from correlative findings. And here we have a few tools. And so first let's do, you know, a fairly straightforward hypothesis. Okay, we believe that near 71 fluctuations are probably acting on insulin signaling to determine lifespan, right? So what's the standard approach that you use to ask if some gene activity acts through some pathway, right? What do? We knock it out. And so, you know, we can do that. And so here's this cohort plot in a DAF16 knockout. So no insulin signaling activity. No DAF16 activity, that transcription factor at the bottom of insulin. And you see that there is still this sort of change in expression over time of miR-71, but it doesn't at all correlate with the lifespan of an individual. The cohort, these are no longer really well separated. There's no longer an individual correlation either. And so what that's saying is that whatever miR-71 GFP is reporting on is going through DAF16 activity. So this is your standard epistasis experiment, but now our phenotype is GFP correlates with lifespan rather than the phenotype being, you know, some more standard phenotype. Is everyone comfortable with this? Okay, so again, you know, we're using mutants to take care of the activity of a given gene in the way that, you know, a mafioso will take care of someone. But my whole point in life is to try to understand what's going on in a wild-type animal to determine lifespan. And, you know, mutants are weird. DAF16 is a sick, short-lived animal. So is there some way that we can do a genetic suppression experiment without having to use a knockout? I'd be interested in that. And one of the reasons is that mutants, again, are weird. And not necessarily emblematic of what wild-type biology is. So let me give you an example. Often people will do sort of guilt by association analysis, where you'll do, you know, RNA-seq in a long-lived DAF2 mutant and compare it to a short-lived DAF16 mutant and say, well, the difference is, you know, something that's up in DAF2 is probably pro-longevity because the worms are long-lived, and something that's up in DAF16 is probably, you know, anti-longevity because, you know, these are short-lived sick worms. So this is the profile of miR-71 GFP in wild type versus DAF16 animals. And you can see in DAF16 animals, these short-lived animals have a ton of miR-71 GFP expression. So from sort of a naive guilt by association, you'd say, oh, lots of miR-71 must be bad. Whereas we know that lots of miR-71 is in fact good. So I propose that what's happening is there's a feedback loop that this poor animal is trying desperately to get some DAF16 activity, so it's cranking up the miR-71 levels to try to repress the insulin signaling. The animal doesn't know that there's no DAF16 around to begin with. You know, it's a dirty trick. But I think this is an example of how sort of mutant physiology is not wild-type physiology. And so instead of taking care of a gene by getting rid of it, could we just statistically control for the effects of a given gene? And this seems weird in genetics. What do you mean statistically control? But you know, think about it from the context of epidemiology, say. You know, we're very comfortable with the idea of an epidemiologist saying, all right, eating McDonald's is correlated with cardiovascular disease. Okay, sure. And triglyceride intake is also correlated with cardiovascular disease. And then, you know, you would totally be unsurprised if the epidemiologist said, well, once we control for triglyceride intake, eating at McDonald's is no longer a risk factor for cardiovascular disease. You can sort of separate the proximate and the more distal risk factors by doing statistical controls. You say, well, maybe they were just eating salads at McDonald's. The real thing we care about is triglyceride intake. Right? Does this seem like a reasonable sort of inference that people make all the time? So we can do the same thing with gene activity. I mean, that's controlling for the level of DAS-gene activity. Does miR-71 still correlate with lifespan? And so we don't have a great measure of DAS-16 activity. It didn't in this data set. We're working on getting a nice, reliable reporter for DAS-16 activity that we trust. But fortunately, the body size of the animal is actually a pretty good readout for DAS-16 activity. Again, unsurprising, body size is related to insulin dosage. And this is, you know, in an allelic series of DAF2 and DAF16 mutants, David Jims has shown that the stronger the insulin mutant, the bigger the worm is. So the relationship is backwards compared to every other species in the world, but there's still a body size insulin relationship. So we're going to use the length of the animal as sort of our readout for insulin activity. And then we have our readout for miR-71 activity, this GFP. And so this is what the data show, that miR-71 is correlated with lifespan, the length is correlated with lifespan, and that these two are correlated with each other. And I can draw like arrowheads because we know we measured this afterwards. So we know that lifespan didn't cause, you know, length. We know that the correlation goes in, that the causation goes in that direction. And so I ask, well, if we control for length, does miR-71 still correlate with lifespan? The answer is no, it doesn't. What about if we control for miR-71, does length still correlate with lifespan? The answer is yes, it does. So that tells us that miR-71 is not bringing any new information to the table once you know how long the worm is. And so we can put together this sort of causal diagram, which is really saying this, that we believe that miR-71, which we read out via this GFP, is affecting insulin signaling levels, which we read out via length, which is determining lifespan. Again, this is like not a really profound finding. We know all of this from the genetics, but this is a proof of concept to show that we can put together simple pathway relationships without having to use mutant genetics. And then we can come up with a set of rules for statistical epistasis, where if we have two different reporters for different genes, we can ask, are they acting in parallel, where we would expect that the correlation coefficients would add up and that we would get independent information about lifespan, or is one upstream or downstream of the other? We can do these sort of control experiments asking, does B bring new information to the table that A didn't, or vice versa? And then you can also ask if there's sort of more complicated patterns. So we can rewrite the standard rules of genetic analysis in the context of asking questions about reporter genes. And so that's what we're doing now. We're trying to actively sort out of all of these microRNAs that we found, what are the relationships between the microRNAs? What are the relationships? What are the pathway relationships? Are they all dependent on DAF16? Are some of them reporting on different pathway activity, activity of different pathways that are relevant for lifespan? So we're trying to sort that out now. But to give sort of the proximate answer, the genetic drivers, you know, one, that certainly variability in insulin signaling does drive variability in individual lifespan. And that there are potentially other regulatory circuits as well, and two students in my lab are working on this. Now, you know, okay, Zach, you have now taken 35 minutes to tell me that insulin signaling has something to do with lifespan. You know, why do we bring this guy out here? But I think it was not necessarily a foregone conclusion that even though you can take a sledgehammer to insulin signaling and make the animal forcibly live a lot longer or a lot less long, that the just because of that doesn't mean that you would necessarily know that there is fluctuation within a wild-type population in insulin signaling. Maybe insulin signaling is so important that it's really well buffered that there is no fluctuation, or that sort of endogenous levels of fluctuation couldn't possibly be big enough to have a lifespan effect. But no, it turns out that it seems like at least, you know, to 50% of the lifespan may be determined by the animal dialing up and down insulin signaling within a physiologically relevant level. And I think that is an interesting finding that you wouldn't necessarily know just from, you know, sort of our history with insulin signaling. All right, any questions on this section of the talk? Okay, so next I'm going to, yeah.
Can you measure the fluctuation of insulin signaling in individual animal, or
Right. Eating a little tricky. We'd love like biosensors for like AMP kinase or something to get sort of, you know, ATP levels. And then obviously there are GFPs that are supposed to be good reporters of DAF16 activity. And we're trying to build up a stable that we trust and, you know, get everything crossed into everything else so that we can ask these. So yeah, length is sort of a crummy proxy, but it serves as a proof of concept.
Typical antibodies for mammals who look at insulin signaling molecules were important. IRS proteins.
I don't honestly know. We haven't explored that mostly because permeabilizing the animal, then you know, you're not going to find out how long it would have lived. Which is unfortunate because, you know, all the assays you'd love to do are fatal.
Trying to think about how best to frame this question because it's complicated. But so you think that you and others think that insulin signaling in you near 71 is important for lifespan, is driving the lifespan extension. So what if instead of calling it lifespan extension, you call it, you know, death? So what time of death is happening?
Yeah.
How do you know that the beer 71 is one mediated extension of lifespan? How do you know that the death process doesn't start earlier in life and it's what's causing the changes in beer 71 insulin signaling?
Right, no, that's a really good question. We don't. You know, it could be that the death process that insulin signaling levels are a result of some other process that drives death. But if that were the case, you would not expect that then in the DAF16 knockout, so you would expect that in the DAF16 knockout that there would still be variability in insulin signaling driven by variability in the sort of death-causing process. So if DAF16 isn't a causal intermediate between insulin signaling and death, then you would expect that knocking it out wouldn't change anything. Because you'd have your insulin signaling level, your miR-71 level would be a reporter for some other thing that's happening. And so the DAF16 experiment is a good one. The better experiment, which we're actively doing, is a miR-71 knockout. You know, is miR-71 actually required for the GFP reporter to be meaningful? Maybe the miR-71 GFP reporter is actually, you know, a reporter for some other transcription factor that's causing death. So, you know, we can use classic genetics and knockouts to try to get at causality in that way. So I don't want to pretend that knockouts are useless.
Can you use a conditional knockout? So you age them to whatever age where you start to see the differences in miR-71 level and then, you know, increase.
That would be that. Those are great experiments, especially for genes that are, you know, important for development. We're sort of lucky that miR-71 is dispensable for development. Oh, yeah, yeah.
For example, if you look at miR-71,
yeah,
you can go to 4 to 6 to 5 to 7, there's no difference.
Right.
But
right.
If you look at miR-78, there's a huge difference, right?
Yeah.
So, could you argue that miR-78 is more important than light-like?
Right. Yeah, that's a really interesting question. We're not totally sure what to do with that. So again, here we're plotting just how well you can predict future lifespan from the expression pattern. And so some of these genes turn on earlier, some of these genes turn on later. But when they become predictive is not necessarily the same time as when the expression is peaking. In the miR-71 case, it was. And that's really interesting, right? Like, how is the physiology changing such that now this level, the level of this gene can affect future lifespan, whereas before it couldn't. These are really rich questions that are going to take a while to dig into, but we're absolutely interested. And not only, you know, when, but remember, we have images. We have tissue-specific expression patterns. We can start to parse out, does expression in the neurons matter or expression in the intestine matter? And for VITA71, we found that it's expressed in the intestine robustly, but the thing that correlates with future lifespan is the expression of this gene in the neuron, in the head region. That we get a much better correlation with future lifespan. So we can start to parcel out sort of both spatially and temporally what are the important windows when lifespan might be determined by different processes. So I think that'll be really interesting.
Are you only looking at miRNAs which are positively correlated with lifespan, or is this a mix of positive?
Great question. Yeah, R squared is positive because it's squared. But yeah, some of these are positively correlated, some of these are negatively correlated with lifespan. So it's an important, number one control. Are you sure it's not just any GFP is going to be positively correlated with lifespan? So we found that many GFPs are not correlated with lifespan. Of those that are, some are positively correlated and some are negatively correlated. We don't, and in ways the sort of the genetics that we know about make sense more or less. Some of them we don't know about the genetics, so those are even more exciting. But. All right, okay. So then the last part of the talk, I want to get into the question of what is the physiology of long life? Did the longer lived animals live better? Seems like a fairly important question to ask. And this, an MD PhD student in my lab tackled this question. And so here's how we think about approaching the question. So let's imagine some simplified situation with the notional idea of health, where it's really simple. It works like it does in a video game. You start out with a certain amount of health, and then when you run out, you're dead. And so there's a few different ways that the trajectory, the decline in health, could differ between long and short-lived individuals in a sort of notional setup. First, maybe every individual starts out with the same amount of health, and then the long-lived animals just sort of spend their health more wisely over time. So I call this the live-fast, die-young scenario. Or it could be that some animals just start out better, right? They're born with the silver spoon in their mouth. So we have this sort of endowment effect that determines lifespan by where you start out. Another possibility is that maybe everyone starts out the same and ages at the same rate, and death is just completely random and unpredictable, and you're cut. Some of them are just cut down in their prime. This is like getting hit by a bus. Completely unrelated to your physiological well-being. So these are sort of three limit cases for what is undoubtedly a continuum, but these are our kind of notional models. Okay, so this is fantasy. How does this look in reality? So here I'm going to plot these parameters that we've measured that seem to be relevant to health and aging, the sort of intestinal autofluorescence. And we see, there are differences in the shape of the trajectory in autofluorescence between short and long-lived animals. So that means, again, midlife, we can predict your future lifespan based on whether you're high autofluorescence or low autofluorescence. Same thing, we can look at the trajectories of movement, and we see that there's a difference between short and long-lived animals in terms of their decline in movement over time. And, our tissue integrity score, the Egg-Lang score, body size score, all of these, we see differences in the shape of the trajectory between short and long-lived animals in a way that is predictive of future lifespan. So to my mind, then, if you have a bunch of different signals that seem to be saying something similar, but they're all kind of noisy, what do you do when you have a bunch of noisy signals? You want to figure out a way to average them together. How do we average together all of these different physiological parameters to make a single measurement of good health, of how happy an individual is at a given time point? And so the way we decided to do that was to note, again, that each of these is individually predictive of future lifespan. So let's just put them all together into a multivariate regression model, just like I've been doing throughout the talk. How well can we predict future lifespan from your physiological measurements today? Right, it's like you go into the doctor's office and the doctor says, you have the heart of a 40-year-old based on your EKG and your whatever else, your CT scan. And if you're 60, you're happy to hear that. And if you're 20, you're not happy to hear that. So this is sort of, we're going to try to take our measurements and estimate how many days of life you have remaining. And we're going to call that our prognosis, so sort of our proxy for how healthy the animal is. And we can get into a detailed discussion about what in Lord's name does health even mean. But I think you would be hard-pressed to come up with a coherent definition of good health that didn't incorporate fundamentally the concept that that individuals you want to call healthy ought to live longer than individuals that you believe are unhealthy. Right? That seems like a basic part of the definition. And it turns out we can do this regression in a bunch of different ways. We can try to predict future lifespan based on how you look today. We can try to predict your instantaneous risk of death based on how you look today. We can try to predict how old you are based on how you look today, so sort of a biological age score compared to the real chronological age. All of those different variants of the regression, and whether we use linear or nonlinear regression, it doesn't matter. So this is great. These results are totally robust to all of the math that underlies it. So I feel comfortable presenting them to you. Okay, so with that out of the way, this is a sort of trajectory for short-lived cohorts of individuals versus long-lived cohorts. This is how health changes on average for these different cohorts. So now we can compare the reality of the situation to our sort of three notional models and ask which one fits reality better. And in particular, each of the models makes different predictions. The Live-Fast-Die-Young model says, okay, what really should correlate with lifespan is the slope of the curve. And we see, yes, indeed, the slope of each individual animal, so each dot here is how quickly, on average, an animal's health is declining, plotted against its lifespan. And we see a fairly tight correlation. The variable endowment model says that where you start out should correlate with your lifespan. And we see no correlation between your starting health and your lifespan. And then this sort of stochastic death model says that your health when you die is what determines your lifespan. And we see a little bit of an effect there. There's some correlation. But really, the story is in the slope. And so that tells us that really it is sort of a live fast, die young scenario. These animals look physiologically identical at the beginning of adulthood and then rapidly diverge. But remember the miR-71 story. Even at the beginning of adulthood, they're starting to look different in terms of their gene expression. And then a few days later, these gene expression states are being manifest in physiological differences that we can see in terms of who's healthy and who's unhealthy. Okay, so that's sort of our first order approximation. But remember, these curves aren't straight lines. So the next question I want to ask is, well, what about the shape of the curve? Because you could imagine, for any individual that lived 10 days, maybe you do have a straight line decline. Or maybe you stay really healthy and then plummet right at the end, or maybe you do most of your getting unhealthy early and spend most of your life in ill health. And so the shape of the curve matters a lot. And we see that, again, even within individuals that live the same lifespan, very different patterns in decline. So here's one individual. It's computationally straightened out, and I'm showing it at every day of its adult life. And the color coding over here is according to our health score. So green means we think it's got a lot of days left. Red means we think it's doing pretty bad. And so here's an animal. You see it's shifting into oranges and yellows pretty early. This animal is getting unhealthy relatively early in its life. And you can see that. It's getting these huge vacuoles. And there's fluid homeostasis problems. We're losing intestinal cells. It's getting all skinny. Eventually the animal looks like scrambled eggs and it's sort of hypertrophic gonad. So there's a lot going wrong with this animal. Here's another individual that lived the exact same number of days, but again, both according to the color-coded score and our own sort of visual intuition about orderly versus disorderly. This animal looks like it's keeping it together a lot better. So I'm going to switch back. So here's the animal that didn't keep itself together, the animal that did. And again, you don't necessarily have to be a worm aficionado, I don't think, to see some difference between those two. So really, the shape of the curve is an interesting parameter that's not necessarily related to lifespan. But now we want to ask the question, is there a systematic difference in the shape of the curve between short and long-lived animals? And the answer is yes. If we stretch out these curves, so they're all unit length, so now we're just looking at the shape of the curve. We see the long-lived animals have this sort of concave shape that we didn't like, that, you know, you're getting unhealthy early. And then if we say, well, let's pin them to start at the same point and end at the same point, so we're just purely looking at the shape and not even concerning ourselves with the fact that some are dying a little healthier looking. Again, we see the same effect, that the long-lived animals have this real concavity. So what does that mean? One term that is frequently bandied about is health span, the span of good health. And so let's just threshold our health score into healthy scores and unhealthy scores. So we're going to define the threshold so that 50% of worm life days are across the whole population are unhealthy and 50% are healthy. The median health score. We'll call that healthy versus health span versus gero span. And this is, the results are pretty robust to the threshold we choose. And so for each individual or each cohort, we can ask what fraction of its life is spent in the healthy phase versus the unhealthy phase. And here again, we can pull this out to look at the relative fraction versus chronological time. And again, you can see the long-lived animals are spending a much larger fraction of their life in the unhealthy phases. So we can make a plot of the fraction of life healthy versus the fraction of life unhealthy for the short-lived cohorts versus the long-lived cohorts. And so what you can see is that longer-lived animals do get more days of good health, unambiguously. They just get even more days of bad health. And so that's what changes the ratio, that we see that this sort of ratio of good health to bad health is systematically getting worse the longer your life is. So that's a problem.
Have you looked at the human data sets to see if this actually follows the female pattern? Because women live longer with more disabilities, and these are anatomically human.
Right. So I haven't specifically looked sort of female versus male. There is an active debate in the human literature about whether sort of advances in modern medicine have extended disability-free or disability time. So that's sort of one side of the literature says that, and I think this was in women specifically, that most of the time that's been tacked on has been disability time, not disability-free time. On the other hand, there's other studies in the literature looking at centenarians that are showing that centenarians have more disability-free time, but again, they're not always asking about the ratio. You say, yeah, you do get more days of good, but what about the days of bad? And so it's been a little tricky to reconcile the human literature.
But they might be newcomers, the centenarians, right?
Yeah.
So maybe that, for the larger population numbers, yours are, wild people.
Right. And so that's a great seg, because that leads into the question, so we have this relationship between lifespan and health span. What's happening in the longevity mutants? Do they just follow the same relationship, or do some of the longevity mutants fundamentally break that relationship? Because maybe that's what's happening in the centenarians. So our short answer right now is, short-lived individuals seem to age faster. They get looking ugly quicklier. So looking uglier more quickly. But at the same time, the extra lifespan that long-lived individuals experience is mostly due to an extension in sort of decrepitude. So the last couple minutes, I just want to talk about our analysis of longevity means. Where on the sort of wild-type continuum the various long-lived mutants fall? And this is work by Drew Sinha, another MD PhD student in my lab. And so these are without ceremony the results. If we look chronologically at a collection of classic mutants, so here's wild type, healthy, unhealthy span of life. We've looked at IFE2, a translation initiation mutant, CLOCK1, which is in the electron transport chain, and AGE1, which is that PI3 kinase right downstream of the insulin receptor. These are all long-lived mutants. And you see they all do get more days of good health and also days of bad health. And then we have two short-lived mutants that are involved in its transduction or in response to the insulin signal, DAF16 and PQM1, another transcription factor. And then NEV1, a short-lived electron transport chain mutant. And then if you look at relative, it's sort of all over the place. Some long-lived mutants have a larger fraction of healthy, some short-lived mutants have a larger fraction of healthy, and then there's this insulin signaling mutant that seems to be spending a big chunk of its life on healthy. And this result echoes some results, some controversial results in the worm literature, that there was fair criticism of and unfair criticism of, and it was all a mess. But at the end of the day, I think the finding is right, that the insulin signaling mutant spends a lot longer of its life looking pretty crummy. But that's not the whole story. And that was why there was this kerfluffle in the literature. One party would say, well, you know, this animal spends a larger fraction of its life looking crummy, and the other party would say, yeah, but it spends many more days looking good. And, you know, how do you adjudicate between these two claims, which are sort of fundamentally irreconcilable? But what I think is that this is a bad way to look at the data, especially because we have longitudinal information. We have information across the entire population, not just these sort of population means like you can get from cross-sectional studies. But we can actually ask, what is the shape of the lifespan versus fractional health span curve? And so this is wild type, and this is age one. And so again, you know, wild type, the shorter lived animals spend a larger fraction of their life healthy. The longer lived animals spend a smaller fraction of their life healthy. So the dots are individual animals, and I'm plotting a trend line as well as sort of the grand mean. And let's get rid of the dots just to compare the trend lines. Because what we see is really interesting. Yes, the mean age one animal, the mean, you know, it lives longer, but it spends a lower fraction of its life healthy. That doesn't seem like a great thing, right? That this fraction has gone down. That's what the bar plot that I showed demonstrates. But when we have access to the full curve, you can see that you would never want to be a wild type individual. For any given lifespan, the age one curve always has a better relative, you know, better fractional health span. For any given fraction of your life you might spend healthy, the age one has more total life. You know, I can't imagine a scenario where you would prefer to be on that curve than that curve. So I think that the sort of kerfluffle in the literature was like the philosophers feeling different parts of the elephant. But when you see the whole elephant, this whole relationship between lifespan and health span, you can say yes. The mean has been pushed down a little bit, but it's also been pushed out so far that age one really dominates. This is a term in economics. So this curve dominates that curve. It's better in every respect. I think both parties to the dispute were right, it turns out. But what I also think this means is that this relative health span or fraction of life healthy is a really weird number, and it doesn't necessarily relate to things that are important in the way that we value. So instead what I'm plotting here is the total, the chronological health span versus the chronological lifespan. So again, this is wild type. And what we see is again, chronological health span saturates. After a certain point, you don't get more days of good health. So this is again the same result we saw before, just a different way of looking at it. That after a while, you can live longer without getting any extra days of good health. Again, this is the same result that I've been talking about. So again, note that there's a lot of scatter around the trend line, but we're just going to look at the trend line. So here's the wild type trend line, and then here's that trend line now compared to a variety of short-lived mutants. And the interesting thing is, first off, these trend lines are really not distinguishable. There's so much scatter that really... statistically, you really couldn't say that these lines are distinct. So what's going on is that all of these short-lived mutants fall along the wild-type relationship between lifespan and health span. They've just been pushing the mean sort of to the shorter life regions without changing the fundamental relationship. So these mutants don't break the relationship. They just move where you are around on the curve. On the other hand, some of the long-lived mutants are very different. So again, here's a wild-type. This translational initiation, I know the curve looks very different, but again, these are not statistically very distinct. And so this mutation seems to basically change your position on this wild-type long life versus good health curve without fundamentally altering the nature of the deal. On the other hand, clock one fundamentally alters the number of days of good health that you might be able to experience. So, right, IFE2, you don't get more days of good health, you just get more days. Clock one, some individuals do get more days of good health. The saturation point is higher. Although, interestingly, the age, the lifespan at which the elbow happens is not affected. So this seems to have just upped the total health span capacity. Whereas age one, this insulin signaling mutant, there's really not a lot of a relationship between lifespan and health span. Most of the animals are able to get very close to this sort of plateau good health. So another way of saying that is in age one, most individuals are able to live to their sort of maximum decrepitude and then, you know, continue on for some time after that. Whereas in all of these others, some of the individuals don't get to live out to maximum decrepitude. And so now we go from thinking like, oh, it's so terrible that age one animals spend a huge amount of their time unhealthy, to thinking like, oh, this is great. All of the animals get to sort of experience as much health as you could experience. So again, two sides of the same coin, and why asking that sort of fractional help can be a little weird. And so now the question is, well, you know, are these additive? In a double mutant, do we get, you know, even more health span? Does the genetics of health span and the genetics of how these curves are affected by different mutants, does that follow the genetics that we already understand for lifespan in terms of what pathways are additive and non-additive with respect to lifespan? So we're doing those experiments. So that gives us sort of the third answer, that the lifespan versus health span curve, the full relationship across a population of long life versus good health, is a really rich phenotype, and we can start to parse out genetics of that phenotype and ask, how can we modulate these properties together, or are there mutants that really separate these properties? Like age one appears to really separate lifespan and health span. Okay, so with that, I'll thank you for your time. I'll acknowledge everyone in my lab, and be happy to take any more questions.